then we have some Phi Eta Sigma and Phi Kappa Phi. Those are some of our campus-wide Greek honor societies. One is for freshmen, one is for juniors, seniors, and graduates. All right, so here's, I'm gonna give you a brief introduction into, you know, what do you do to find a scholarship and apply? These are the steps you'll go through: find, research, prepare, contact, and apply. As Cory mentioned, you can go to our website, and if you click on recommended scholarships, it will take you to some of those big name ones I was outlining there on that list. But maybe you're not the 3.8 to 4.0 student, maybe you're kind of like a B plus student, but you still want to have a scholarship, there are scholarships for you. And so we have a link on our homepage for other scholarships. You can go in and indicate what you're looking for, whether it's study abroad or whether it's an anthropology scholarship, and it will pull up a list of scholarships we're aware of. We don't really work closely with those applications. We work with the recommended scholarship applications to give you advice and feedback, but I just want you to know that resource is available. Some of you might even be getting emails once a month from your department. We send it to the departments for them to forward to their students. We call it scholarships to note. And we also have a column in the Daily Universe each week that outlines some of the scholarships and the deadlines approaching. So you just need to get to know the scholarships, the eligibility requirements, read if you're competitive. Have I done enough to be competitive for this? And then give yourself ample time to prepare. And that's both mostly what we're going to be talking about today, is what would require ample time. Here's a list of some of the things that you ought to be doing to be a competitive student at the national level. So take challenging classes, get work, research, internship, or volunteer experiences. You can't only take classes and get a 4.0. That will not win you that scholarship. There's so much competition out there. You have to be a little different from everyone else. You have to stand out. So if you hear of some summer workshop you could go to that only 80 students in the United States get to participate in, give it a try. See if you can be one of those 80 students, because again, that sets you apart, you're different. Develop a global perspective. Be sure you know what's going on in the world around you. I skipped one. Develop meaningful relationships. I mean mostly with faculty, because they're gonna have to write your letters of recommendation, and you can have a great application and strong essays, but just a couple weeks ago, I saw a letter of recommendation that was 10 lines long from a professor. I won't tell you the college, but you know, he just had no clue how to write a letter of recommendation, I think. And you know, I had to write back to him and say, you know, we still have time. Would you be willing to rewrite this letter? But if I hadn't seen it and it had gone straight to the competition, that would have lost the student the scholarship. So you need to kind of keep your ear to the ground, like who writes really good letters of recommendation? And I mean, if you have to be kind of strategic. And you also want to make sure that you're not just, you know, if you were looking for a good grade, I'd call you a grade grubber. If you're looking for a good letter of recommendation, what's the word for that? I don't know. But you want to make sure that you are developing meaningful relationships. You're getting to know the faculty on a personal level. Maybe you're helping with research, or you play racquetball every Thursday or something like that, where they get to know you. And then you can seek out leadership positions. And this ought to be, you don't want to like just be a leadership position for something you don't care about. It has to be something that excites you. And then also try to get involved in international experiences. We had a student apply for the Rhodes Scholarship. Absolutely fantastic student, 4.0 GPA, double major, completely different colleges, you know, so it was impressive. Had done research at three different places, had published, no international experience except his mission. And the way these national scholarship reviewers look at it, the mission is a restricted activity kind of experience. We look at it differently. We're like, wow, 2 years in Taiwan, that's great. Or 2 years in Germany, awesome. you've got a language, you come back with all that cultural experience, but these reviewers look at it as you didn't purposely choose to go to Taiwan, you were assigned to go to Taiwan. Do we give you credit for that? No, they don't. So we had a student a few years ago apply for the Rhodes Scholarship, and word got back to us, you know, in the unofficial route, that people on the committee felt that a student that did a three-month volunteer experience at a NGO in Bangladesh was more qualified internationally than our two-year mission student to Taiwan. You know, that was how they rated the international experience. So the lesson to be learned is you need to have some kind of international experience, go out of the country, but it needs to be something of your choice. If you did go to Taiwan on a mission, follow it up. Follow it up and say, I learned to love the culture, I went back and I did this research, I did my honors thesis, something like that, okay? So follow it up. Let's go on. Other people to know, sometimes on campus there's a scholarship advisor. Like Cory Leonard just told you, he's the advisor for the undergraduate Boren Scholarship. You'll want to meet with him and tell him, I think I'm interested in applying. What's your advice for me? Also, you're going to be looking for at least two to three recommenders for most scholarships. And then there's a trick to asking for these letters of recommendation. You don't just go up to them after class when they're surrounded by a bunch of students and say, hey, can you write me a letter of recommendation? No, you want to ask, can I get a commitment from you that you can write me a strong letter of recommendation? I've prepared a set of bullet points right here, and I've also given you my resume, and I've attached some of my papers I've written for your class to refresh your memory so you can see your comments on those papers. But I think you could give me a strong recommendation. And then they have to respond, and if they're like kind of lukewarm, look elsewhere, you know, because some faculty, not all, but some, don't know how to say no. And that's how you get those 10-line letters of recommendation, which if they're looking for a page and a half, that's going to lose you the scholarship. So you have to do your part to provide the information to the faculty. They have hundreds of students. You're just one. You have to remind them, tickle their memory, like, oh, yeah, I do remember saying that was the best paper I'd read in 5 years on that topic. You have to remind them by giving them the paper. So help them out in that way. And then you have to give them time to do it. And faculty are busy, right? So there have been times when I've told students, all right, it's past the 2 weeks. Make an appointment, go sit in the office so that any students passing by in the hall will not go in and take up the professor's time, but you're sitting there so they'll pass by and come back some other time, and that way you're saving time for the professor to write the letter while you're there, you know? So that's another way. They might want to keep it confidential and turn the monitor away from you, that's their privilege, but at least you're carving out time for them to work on that letter of recommendation. All right, so Know your deadlines, whether it has to be postmarked by that date or just mailed in or just submit electronically, whatever. All right, let's keep going. So, and then if you don't get the first scholarship, you keep trying. For example, that student I was telling you about who was the 4.0 with a major in German and physics, he kept trying. He didn't get the Rhodes, he didn't get the Marshall. He applied for the Phi Kappa Phi scholarship, and he was one of the three in the whole nation to get $15,000. So, no, he got something. You keep trying. All right, so competitive writing strategies. So for applications, you usually have a personal statement essay, and then some scholarships have additional essay prompts that you have to answer. And remember, it's not a short answer. It is a thesis statement. Even if it's just a one paragraph, you're writing an organized paragraph. Okay, so what is the personal statement? It's not a narrative of your life. I'm the fourth of eight children, and ever since I was 2 years old, no, we're bored already. It's not a narrative of a single event in your life. It's not a listing of everything on your resume, nor is it a research proposal. So look on the other side here. What is it? It's a well-crafted, audience-aware description. In other words, well-crafted, you've put a lot of time and thought into it. Audience-aware means you know who you're writing to, you know what they're looking for, you're going to give it to them. And then you tell them who you are, why you are who you are, what shaped you, and why you're intending to move forward in this trajectory. You're on a trajectory. You're here. You entered as a freshman. Then you took this, and you're going this direction. You can't flop over here and then come back. It just doesn't make sense on the trajectory. So you're explaining to them what your trajectory is, even beyond what you'll do after you win this financing. Okay, so this book at the top here, I want to recommend that as a good source for you to go to find out more information about writing a personal statement. I'm briefly going to share some of the highlights of that, but it's a whole chapter of a book. So it's chapter 7, How to Write About Yourself, from a book by Donald Asher, Jason Morris, and Nicole Fazio-Vagel. But basically what this is saying is, reflect on key moments in your life, and hopefully those have guided your decisions since then and put you on that trajectory. So that's kind of how to get started on this personal statement. The personal statement is going to help them understand who you are, what makes you tick. Okay, so developing your personal statement, which is going to be referred to as PS in a few of the following slides, gives you the opportunity to tease out those key moments that have shaped your interests and pursuits. Notice the steps for writing: reflecting, drafting, writing, and revising your statement. I had a student come in this summer and he just gave me his first draft, and I'm like, oh boy, this is a first draft, isn't it? Well, yeah, but I'm a good student. Well, he went through at least 12 different drafts. So it takes time on your part, but you will be glad when you win the scholarship. So it generally describes your personal and professional experiences since the beginning of your undergraduate career. It's kind of hard to go back to middle school or high school. You weren't really shaped yet, supposedly. Maybe you were. You might be different. All right, so here's some steps. Number one, state your ambitions. You're going to communicate those. As I said, beyond getting the funding and beyond, like, what am I doing after this? Comment on how you might contribute to your profession or your discipline. Is there going to be a product from doing this experience? Is there going to be a publication? Are you going to present and share information? Like the Fulbright Scholarship, they love to have you come back and share what you did so that other students want to go and apply for a Fulbright. And then explain precisely why you must study with that particular professor at that particular institution in that particular country on that particular, you know, project. So you have to justify. And then if there's any gaps on your transcript, explain them. This is your chance. Although, beware that if they invite you to come for an interview before you're selected, that's fair game for them to ask, you know. But, you know, because one of my favorite questions when I look at transcripts is like, okay, you had straight A's, but I noticed that you had a B in badminton. Why is that? You know, and then it's kind of a funny question because they'll give a clever answer. They've thought about it. They they know exactly why. Okay, so your point, your whole goal is to pique the review committee's interest with your personal statement. You want to excite them about meeting you personally. So how do you do that? Well, you try to write well so that when they have gone through 25 applications, they're like, ah, finally one that's well written. You know, you want that to be yours. And then you have to catch them in the first, I'd say, 2 minutes of them reading your application, which means it's the introduction. The introduction has to have the hook that catches them. Well, you can go online. There are a lot of helpful sources for how to write good introductions. These are just a few of them. You know, if you start off with a surprising fact or some humor or an anecdote. That's usually kind of interesting. I'm not a fan of starting with quotes. I'd rather hear your writing than someone else's writing. So I put it in there, though. A lot of places list that as a good intro. But you want to be original and not gimmicky. But if what you've decided to write about, you've reflected, and now you're ready to write, if you can come up with that interesting introduction paragraph, you've got them. All right, then you leave time for this self-reflection we've been talking about. That means going back and starting from the moment you were cognizant of your dreams, your ideals, your ambitions, and then that probably creates a timeline for you. Well, what did I do next? And then what happened? And what reinforced that idea? These are the things that you could probably write in your personal statement. So to get the ideas flowing, you can start listing all the papers you've written, labs, research, projects, conferences you've presented at, things that fit along that trajectory. Like, yeah, that's right, and then that happened. Okay, you might want to share that this has just been a naturally unfolding process for you. And it's become rather unique because you've done the following. Okay, and then you want to know the basics, like how many words am I allowed? So know your word count. You want to avoid jargon. Like if you're applying for the Goldwater Scholarship and you're a science major, and you start dropping all these heavy science terms, you better hope your reviewer is a science in the science discipline. Okay, but that's not most of you, I don't think. Let's say that you're going to start using all this specialized verbiage from anthropology. Well, maybe your reviewer's from political science. He might understand that anthropology stuff, but wouldn't it be nice if you wrote in such a way that it's not dummied down, but it's explained. Tailor your statement to the purpose of this opportunity. Don't just recycle essays you've written for other things. Make sure it's specific. And then you also have to not be afraid to shine. You want to show that you stand out from other people, but you don't want to come across as egocentric. So if you brought your essay into my office and it's returned to you with 57 uses of the pronoun I on one page, you were egocentric. You know, avoid the use of too many personal pronouns. Because I don't want to sound like Obama, but no one's self-made, right? There were people who helped shape you into who you are. So you have to find that fine balance of having humility and being teachable, but also recognizing that you have a unique set of talents that you want to continue to develop. All right, so the things to avoid, the first-person pronouns I talked about, references to any past family or personal trauma, because then you're playing the sympathy card and it gets a little trite. You might want to avoid political or personal subjects because it could be that you're making the reviewer uncomfortable. Or maybe they hate Republicans and you took your stance was very Republican. You know, they're liberal. You don't know your audience, so why would you go out on that limb? Think about what you're writing. Think about your audience. If you don't know, you don't want to be too extreme in this essay. Because, again, that they're just going to take that paper and flip it over. I'm like, I'm sure there's a better applicant. You want to avoid LDS jargon. And I can't stress this enough. I see it all the time. And I don't want you to think I'm anti-LDS. I'm not. I have a strong testimony. But this is not the time to try to convert your reader. And they have no clue what a Relief Society president or an Elders Quorum president is, nor what that entails. They have no clue, so it really does you no good to mention it. Unless you can couch it in terms that they'll understand. For example, we had a Truman Scholarship winner a few years ago who won from the state of Hawaii. She applied from BYU Hawaii, not from BYU Provo. But she told us that when she wrote her Truman application, she was first counselor in her ward's Relief Society presidency. So what she said is, education counselor in one of the largest women's organizations in the world, responsible for the following. She was factual. It was a lot easier for them to swallow than saying first counselor in Relief Society. And so you're trying to find that balance between a too academic tone and a dispassionate tone, okay? That's why you go through so many drafts. Now, I'm reaching the end of my presentation. I think I've taken too much time already, so I'm gonna really breeze through this last part. I have about three slides of a sample winning Fulbright application. Now, let me just give you a description of what a Fulbright is. A Fulbright is where we have graduating seniors or graduate students who can apply to go to a country for 1 year to study or research or a combination of both. So it's kind of like going over and doing your ORCA project in a country for a year, all expenses paid, right after senior year when you really need a break before you go into your graduate studies. What a great opportunity. You know the sad thing? This year we have less than a dozen applicants. And the sad thing to me about that is that BYU has the market on language because of our missionaries that are coming back to BYU. Think how many, what is it, 70% of BYU undergrads that speak a second language? Why wouldn't our students want to go on a Fulbright? I don't know if they just don't know about it or what, but consider it. Just an idea. So this was a woman who wanted to go to Ukraine. Her field was family sciences, so the way Fulbright defines that, that's psychology. Okay, take a quick read through that page there. I'm not going to read it out loud. Okay, as you find something you like, raise your hand, tell me what it is. What'd she do right?
I like the description of her house right away.
Description. You feel like you're right there. I can picture it. In fact, I feel like I'm her.
I like her list of circumstances.
Yeah, list of circumstances because, and is she playing like, everyone said it was impossible for me, but I did it. And you're like, yeah, go girl. Yes. Don't you imagine that took quite a few drafts to write it in that tight of a prose to be that effective? All right. Oh, did I skip two pages? Okay. Now she talks about going to college, refers back to that dream-forming rail line, talks about her first semester at school bouncing a few checks. You know, she's growing up. She's entering the real world. Getting a BS in economics at the age of 20. Oh, my eyebrows go up. I'm impressed. But more than that, she felt confident that what she dreamed as a little girl in Washington was something she could accomplish. Then she goes further, takes us up to the present time. She went to law school, met her spouse. Now they have 7 kids, and they want to go back to the Ukraine where they had had a previous work experience. And work with Ukraine's government. And she's currently going back to get a master's after she has her law degree, but now she wants to go back to Ukraine with her 7 kids and her husband. All right. You're like, oh my gosh, you're one of a kind, right? She was even better as one of a kind because for the Fulbright, it helps if you have a letter of affiliation from someone, which means someone is willing to sponsor you. Someone is willing to introduce you to the right people, open their libraries, their government resources to you if you're doing research. Her letter of affiliation was from the First Lady of Ukraine. Who's going to deny that Fulbright? Okay, so anyway, this is just one sample of how someone approached it. You don't have to do the same thing because you're different. You're unique. But what you have to do is figure out what makes you unique, how are you going to write that memorable essay to keep you at the top of the list. Maybe they have one scholarship left, and they're like, well, who should we give it to? And they might say, well, what's your tag? What's your hook? What about that, you know, what about that girl that lived by the railroad line? You know, yeah, maybe she'd be that last person. So you have to have something that sticks in the mind. So we've talked about this as we've gone along. There is another kind of essay writing. It's called a proposal. Now, if you go to the ORCA website on campus, are you familiar with ORCAs? Where the Office of Research and Creative Activities in the administration building gives $1,500 to undergraduate students who want to do original undergraduate research if they have a faculty mentor or advisor. You should all be doing that as undergraduates. It's a good thing to put on your resume, but it's also like a scholarship. It's $1,500 they just give you to do this. And what do you have to do in return? Turn in a 2-page report at the end of the year on your findings. Now, supposedly, you're doing a lot of work in the meantime, but I don't want to make it sound like it's too easy.
Yeah.
But really, your advisor gets $300, you get $1,500, you have a year to complete this original undergraduate research, and you're learning how to do that undergraduate research. So then when you apply for a Fulbright or some other graduate scholarship, you have it under your belt already. You've already done research. You know how to write a proposal. You know how to critical problem solve. Maybe you've already published something from that ORCA grant research. The ORCA grant website gives you good advice on how to write a proposal, so I'm not really going to go through this too much with you. They're not all scholarship applications require it, only those where you go and do a project. Okay, so I think that's it from me. Thank you so much.
So a little bit about my background. For 3 years now, I've just been released from that duty. I sat on the National Bourne Scholarship Selection Committee, and so every year I would read dozens, you know, somewhere around 50 or 60 a year, scholarships for Bourne, applications for Bourne scholarships, which it's a long application. It's about 30 pages, with multiple essays and things like that. And this is unpaid, it's unrequited, it's simply out of hide. And I don't get a reduced teaching load for this. I don't have fewer papers, student papers and exams to read for doing this. They asked me to do it and I did it. And so from the beginning, I'm in a bit of a bad mood when I'm reading your application because I've already had a full day at work, I've got the kids to bed, I'm tired, and I start reading applications, and sometimes this is between 10 at night and 2 in the morning. And I finish up reading some of these applications. I'm running back to Washington, D.C. on an airplane, an early flight on some morning. And the only payoff is that my son and his wonderful wife live in Washington, D.C. So I go from the airport and have dinner with him, then go to my hotel, finish reading the applications, go to work the next morning, work all day, and catch an afternoon flight home. So when I'm reading your application, I get irritated with the poorly written applications. I get irritated with students that don't follow instructions. And I'm really looking for applications that grab me and capture my attention and tell me clearly what the student has done with their life, what they plan to do with their life, and how they're going to do that with their life. So kind of three questions. Where have I been? Where am I now? And where am I going? And how am I going to get there? Now, much of what I say will put meat on the bones of what Carolyn has talked about, because over the years I've collected some outstanding essays and some bad essays, and I'm going to actually show you essays so that you can see what a good and a bad essay is. Now, I don't know this necessarily but oftentimes when I read these applications, there are hints that I can tell someone is LDS and they served a mission, because there's hints that are dropped in different ways. So much of this are selected out of applicants who happen to be LDS, because I could tell from their application. In some cases, that's not the case. But so the first question is, you know, dealing with the mission issue. How do you deal with that? Let me give you some examples. Here's a generic answer to the mission question. It's very obvious. It's very generic, And I think there's some other problems with it, but we'll talk about it. So my interest in Japan and the Japanese language began in 2005 when I served a proselyting and service mission for the Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints and lived in Japan for 2 years. I learned the language and came to love the Japanese people. Straightforward statement. In that sense, it's okay, but it's generic. It's just okay. But what turns me off about this statement is something that actually Carolyn said in her own presentation that I disagree. I learned the language and came to love the Japanese people. So my first question is, well, what if you came to hate them? Would you say that? So what's the opposite of I learned to love them? I came to hate them. So would you say that if that was the case? No, you wouldn't. So that in that sense, it's trite. I came to love the Japanese people. Well, okay, so what? Now, so I tend to not like people to use the word love in their applications. And I'll come back to that at the end. Here's another example, and this is just from last year. This is a long example, and it made me very angry. For 2 years, I served as a missionary for the Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints. This mission required a full-time commitment to proselytizing and other service activities with strict observance to mission rules, which included a strictly regulated schedule, the continual company of another missionary, strict guidelines for entertainment, prohibition on dating and other such activities, and contact with family limited to weekly letters and biannual phone calls. For my specific assignment, I was required to become fluent in Cantonese as to be able to work with residents in the city and its surrounding areas. Among the list of duties was tracting, contacting people door to door in the street, etc., teaching people in their homes, community service, and assisting in local church congregations. While there, I served as a district leader for missionaries. So there's a little bit of jargon in here, district leader. But man, this essay, you don't have much time to do this, and this is a long, detailed thing about what missionary life was like. So when I read that, I thought, why did you write that? Too much detail. That doesn't take me anywhere. I mean, I know as a Mormon I would know this, but the experience, so I was a little bit upset at this application. He didn't put his best foot forward in presenting himself as a Mormon and as a scholarship applicant. But then the committee immediately turned to me and go like, what? Do you mean he had to stay with the same person 24/7? He could never be alone? He couldn't go to the movie? What's that all about? And so what did this raise in their minds? It didn't answer questions about the quality of this candidate. It raised questions about what's a Mormon missionary doing living like this? So sometimes you don't want to give a lot of detail. Here's one that's more to the point and shows, as Carolyn pointed out, additional commitment to the language and the country. It's not just learning to love the people. In 1999, my church called me to serve a full-time mission, doesn't even mention the name of the church, for 2 years, so I knew, during which time I achieved a foundation for my language skills and developed these skills through daily life and continual study. I returned to Taiwan to participate in a summer internship. I took this opportunity to apply the new skills I had learned at a different and deeper level than while a missionary. Okay? Bang. I got introduced to Taiwan as a missionary. I studied hard and learned the language, but that wasn't it. I went back. I used my language skills and academic skills and pushed these to a deeper, fuller, richer level, and now I want to go on and pursue that more. So tell them that the missionary experience was the first step, but you've gone way beyond that. That isn't the end. That's only the beginning. So you want to make that point. Now, I'll return to this issue later on about, going on and doing more things. Letters of recommendation. Don't ask your mission president for a letter of recommendation. I know he's the best guy in the world. I know he loved you and you loved him, but don't ask him, because this is the kind of letter you get. It's my pleasure to write this recommendation for JC. I worked very closely with him for 2 years when he was a full-time missionary for the Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints. As his mission president, I supervised his work. JC worked hard, was very reliable and obedient. Because of his dedication and hard work, I was able to assign him to difficult tasks and work in challenging neighborhoods. He got along well with his companions and with those he worked with. Missionary work was very challenging. He faced those challenges in an exemplary manner. He is a fine young man who has high standards and knows the value of service to others. So who isn't that? Would this mission president say, this missionary, he slept in, he didn't read his scriptures. So what does it tell me? He doesn't, your mission president doesn't really know you. Remember that. He knows, he has hundreds of elders and sisters he's trying to keep in balance, and he reads your weekly report maybe or gets a, he doesn't really know you. He doesn't know your academic skills. He doesn't know your other kinds of life skills. He only knows you as a missionary. So it's not really a good recommender. Now, I know this as a reader, and I don't give much credibility to mission president letters, but also I don't give a lot of credibility to some really high famous people. One that I simply set aside after reading who the letter was from was someone who did an internship in Washington, D.C., and Senator Hatch wrote a letter of recommendation. I knew Senator Hatch didn't write that letter. I knew that some intern who was probably an undergraduate student wrote that letter and then used a mechanical pen to sign it. So that's not going to do you any good. But the student probably thought, wow, I've got a letter from Senator Hatch. This is going to open every door for me. So be careful in selecting your recommenders. People that know you can comment specifically on your academic abilities, your preparation to do what you're proposing to do, and things like that. Now, you have to present a clear, cogent plan for what you want to do. Here is an example about something that's way too general. My proposed fellowship program was carefully devised to complement my experience working and living in and studying the language, culture, and people of Thailand. My proposed program includes a combination of focused research and advanced Thai language instruction. The courses proposed will complement my experiences in Vietnam. I'll talk to you more about this particular person. So this person obviously been to Vietnam, is going to go to Thailand. 1 year focused study in Thai studies and advanced Thai language instruction will help me gain regional subject matter expertise. The invaluable experience and knowledge I will gain abroad will be a vital tool that will enable me to provide a value-added factor in whatever post I may take within the federal government after completion of graduate studies. So it's very general. No, you know, I'm going to do some studying, but you know, not some specific kind of proposal. Now, I'll come back to this application later on because it has kind of a funny ending. Here is one, and this is lengthy, but man, this one blew everybody away. We all sat down at the table and says, wow, do you remember that application? And we all remember this application. Now, here it's specific, it's clear, with a very precise plan that this student's going to carry out. The environmental perspectives I gained while living in Japan piqued my interest in sustainability and fostered my desire to study environmental management and sustainability. Okay, where I've come from. I'm applying for this grant to fund research on the feasibility of implementing Japanese waste management techniques in developing countries and to gain critical knowledge of Japanese language and culture. What I'm going to do, why I'm going there. There are two distinct parts to my program. How am I going to do it? An accelerated course in intensive Japanese language and an internship with an Institute for Global Environmental Strategy. Okay, here's where I came from, here's what I propose to do, and here's how I'm going to carry it out. Okay, very clear and precise. Now, a little bit of background. While living in Japan, let me go to the next one. I'm sorry about the red. While living in Japan, I was asked to sort my garbage into 10 different categories, living without central heat in the winter, and rely solely on public transportation for the first time in my life. I witnessed how the country's environmental policies affect individual citizens, and I now look forward to understanding how the country's environmental policies influence industrial operations. Understanding Japan's policies to handle downstream waste and assessing how these policies can be applied in developing countries will improve my ability to make more informed foreign policy decisions as a future employee of the United States government. My program at JKU in environmental management and sustainability focuses on building a sustainable world that will provide for all stakeholders. A sustainable world is essential to ensure global security. Now that I understand sustainability from an American perspective, I will return to Japan to conduct research about waste management techniques and technologies used in Japan. I will expand my knowledge of this topic and gain critical knowledge of the Japanese language before commencing a career in the federal government, okay? We know exactly where she came from, where she's going to go, and how she's going to get there. And man, if you can make garbage interesting, you're going to get a scholarship. And she made garbage collection interesting. We all just thought, wow, that was cool. Those kind of applications excite you. Okay, now, there's some good, not specific enough introductions and some very nice specific introductions. Here, let me talk about some just bad presentation. Simply bad presentation. Poorly written, not clear, bad tone, etc. Let's see, I think this one, Dana, I'll pause. This is actually a flagship program, a Korean flagship. from one of those Korean flagship programs that's not very good, I think. I'm currently in year one of the Asian Studies program at JKU. 16 credit hours a semester of Asian Studies courses is basically my proposal by default. I don't know what that means. Having said that, well, yeah, you said that, but you don't need to tell me that. I read it. I believe firmly that you make your biggest gain in extra individual workouts outside the mandated practice time. I regularly read editorials and current events articles in Korean, and also am always working my way through a Korean novel. I also attempt to squeeze in some comics and modern short stories. Yeah, I know he's trying to prove to me that he is working, making an effort to really improve his Korean, but it's a little bit kind of flippant and kind of, you know, in your face. I always write down new words I encounter while reading and look them up later in a dictionary. Well, I'm glad he does that. Since I'm shooting for the consulate track of the U.S. Foreign Service, I'm going to go all out to land an internship with the U.S. Embassy in Seoul. If I'm denied, though, a consolation prize would be interning at a local NGO-run office. It only goes on. My goal is to force the Foreign Service Selection Committee to take a long, hard look at me by being proficient in Japanese and Korean. In fact, I have a Rudy-like steel determination to get in. I'm not sure. I don't know. Who? I thought it was Rudy Giuliani. So in other words, you know, remember who you're talking to. I've decided to apply to the consular track for several reasons. Less competitive. So I'm not a competitive person. I want to take the easy road. Now you can catch up. I've decided to apply to the consular track for several reasons. Less competitive, more interaction with locals, and I think my personality fits better toiling under relative obscurity than in the political or diplomatic track, where there's bound to be more pronounced elements of elitism. Okay, so this guy wants to be just the average Joe down at the bottom of the ladder and, you know, doesn't want to be competitive. So I think lack of ambition here. I hope my interest, in other words, we don't want to be arrogant, but you don't want to sort of put yourself down or reveal to them, I'm lazy and I don't want to work too hard for this. I hope my interest in immigration policy administration is deemed relevant to U.S. national security interests, broadly defined. And then, this is the coup. The reason I'm currently enrolled in the flagship program is because I calculated that being reasonably proficient in Korean would force the Foreign Service Selection Committee to take a long look at me. Since Korean is a critical needs language, it made sense to further what I'd started Korean language study-wise during my two-year stint in South Korea. Okay, clue, this guy, I think, was a Mormon. I just think that. Additionally, I conclude that without getting this scholarship, I would never be able to have the exposure to Korean I needed to upgrade significantly towards true proficiency. And now the honesty comes through. I'd be lying if I said I wanted Korean language skills so I could contribute to U.S. security in regards to North Korea's lurking nuclear weapons threat. So he's not going to lie to us. He's going to be honest. My only interest in North Korea is are pressing them to reduce the extent of their blatant infringements on basic human rights and in helping North Korean defectors acclimate to South Korea. I hope my Rudy-like determination to be accepted into the Foreign Service is deemed worthy of receiving serious consideration for funding. I mean, this is like, whoa. This guy's gung-ho. And I just thought, you should have proofread this. You should have had someone work with you, sort of like the language. I mean, what he says, he could have said the same thing in a very different way, and it might have been an appealing essay. You know, I'm interested in immigration policy. I'm interested in North Korean human rights issues and refugee resettlement. I'm working on my Korean to try to improve it so I can be effective in doing that. Immigration policy is a big issue for the United States. Refugee resettlement, humanitarian services, big. You could have said the same thing in a very different way, and it would have been appeared to me as a very different purpose. But I only know this person on paper. I don't know who this person really is. Yeah. Now, revealing information about yourself. How much information should you reveal about yourself? How personal should you be? This is always a question. You want to tell them, you want them to get to know you, but yet you don't want to reveal too much because sometimes that raises questions, much like the missionary, very thick description of the missionary experience raised questions rather than answering questions. Here's one that reveals, I'll turn on to him, it reveals, I knew that this person had probably gone on a mission, but the others didn't. That's not a clue they would pick up. But this was the opening sentence, and when we talk about opening sentence that grab our imagination, this one grabbed our imagination. And I'll see if you think the same way. Oh, that's good personal information, so I'd be honest. In 1990, I was merely a boy that only knew Kansas. Today, I'm a man that has lived in Indonesia. I've dedicated my life to understanding Indonesia and plan to live a life abroad serving our nation proudly. Why do you think that was appealing to me and others on the committee? It may be a generational thing, I don't know. Have you guys ever heard of Dorothy? Do you know where Dorothy came from? We're not in Kansas anymore, are we? This is the Wizard of Oz. So my immediate image was, in my mind, was this sort of poor Mormon farm kid from Kansas that then went to Indonesia, and the whole world opened up to this guy, and now he knows he wants to dedicate himself to serving our nation proudly in some kind of foreign service activity or something. It just sparked my interest. And everybody else says, wow, that was just, that first sentence was the boy from Kansas who went to Indonesia. We all remember this application. The boy that went to Kansas, from Kansas to Indonesia, and it just grabbed our attention. So think about how you can hook these people with some kind of little thing, you know, about you.
It won't work if you say from Utah.
Yeah, it might not work from Utah. Say I'm from Parowan. Let them guess what that is, or something like that. No, it wouldn't work if you said from Utah. But the thing, this person knew what they were doing. They knew about Dorothy. They knew about the Wizard of Oz. There's this image that comes with that. And so they sort of knew how that would play with the audience. Now, here's one that shows commitment, goes beyond just the love of the country, very practical in its approach. While many foreign-born lawyers working in Vietnam do not speak Vietnamese, I found speaking Vietnamese to be an invaluable tool. The ability to speak opens doors that most Westerners do not even know exist. It allows one to relate to the culture and people in a totally different way. And from my experience, Vietnamese genuinely appreciate and admire foreigners who spend the time learning their language. That's the same statement as the first one I showed you about the guy who learned to love the Japanese people, but he says it in a different way. He doesn't mention that he was a missionary, but we know that he lived in Vietnam, and learning the language, he realized that these people really appreciate someone who speaks their language, and it opens doors that other foreigners just simply don't know exist because they haven't bothered to learn the language. Okay, here's another one. So this guy wants to practice, he wants to be a lawyer, I think, but he mentions that, but he doesn't. Here's one that's more specific, and it puts the language study in an important context. Now, a lot of our strengths are language from our mission experience, but we need to show that we have other strengths, we have other visions, and language beyond language. Apologies to those who major only in languages. But my plan is to use my Chinese in the field of international law. After consulting with attorneys and other professionals in China, I chose not to major in Chinese. I was advised to make Chinese another tool in the tool belt instead of my only tool. My international relations major sharpens my ability to read, analyze, and write. Fundamental skills for excelling in law school. My business classes hone my understanding of financial and organizational management and prepare me to interface with the burgeoning Chinese economy. Each semester, I continue to register for Chinese courses to polish my ability to speak, read, and write Chinese. My goal is to be able to combine these skills in a way that will make me a valuable asset to an international law firm. So his experience, the way he understands his language, what he wants to do with it, reveals a lot to me about this student. The way he understands the importance of language study, he's committed to it, but the way he puts it in a leather perspective, you know, he's not going for a PhD in language and literature, he wants to be a lawyer, and so he has a professional sense of what the language does for him, and so I have a good understanding of what that student's doing. Those are, I think, all examples of good personal information, kind of revealing what your dreams are and what your desires are in a very effective way. Here's some bad personal information. Let me read this first, and then I'll talk about it. I'm very interested in doing business in Japan. I find business fascinating. I would love to be able to gain sufficient language skills to be able to conduct business either with or within Japan in the language of the people. A career goal is to obtain a job that would allow me to travel to Japan periodically while still allowing me to have my family in the U.S. as I worry about the difficulties of raising a family overseas. This may be a concern you have. You shouldn't, but it may be, but I wouldn't reveal that concern because it tells me here's a person that wants a scholarship, but he doesn't want to really get into the culture. He doesn't want to live there. He doesn't want to, because he's worried about his family or something. Why does he have this concern? Does he not like Japan? What's the problem here? I don't know. Why is this person concerned about this? I was wondering. I've lived overseas. I've lived with my family overseas. It was a great experience. So what's his concern? Why would I fund someone with this concern? Why would I give money to someone that has that concern, that is not really, doesn't love the people? Obviously, this person didn't learn to love the country, the people. I don't know. Now, here's the last slide. Way, way too personal. Going back, this is an excerpt out of an earlier application that I read. This person was flying high when they first wrote this application. They had served in the Army Reserve in an intelligence unit. They had all the check boxes on national security experience and goals in national security. But then their last paragraph of their personal statement revealed just a bit too much. This was this person who had learned Vietnamese and now wanted to learn Thai. And he thought this was, and so I thought, wow, Thai, Vietnamese, this guy's going to be a great Southeast Asian national security person. He has practical experience in military intelligence. And then he wrote this. Last but not least, an equally worth explanation is my personal connection to the Thai language. Now that I have married a Thai, I seek to take my Thai to a new level. I want to interact with my wife more intellectually. She is my best friend and in many ways my language partner. It has become a partnership in love and mutual language development. By improving my Thai, I will be able to better communicate with my spouse, which is the bedrock of a healthy relationship. On occasion, there seems to be a breakdown in certain language aspects that detract from our communication level. I intend to raise the fluency of my Thai through meticulous language study. Improved Thai language proficiency will enable me to be more intimate with my wife and strengthen our marriage. We all looked at each other. Did you read that one? We don't fund marriage counseling and sex therapy, folks. No. This guy was flawed. He was on the top of our charts and went to the very bottom because you could give that to your roommate and they say, oh, you don't want to write that. That's weird. That's kind of yucky. Oh. I mean, you know, don't do that. And anybody could have told you that. Obviously, that person didn't have someone read that. Maybe his Thai wife read it and shared English. Yeah, sure. I think if you spoke better Thai, we could kind of, I'd like sweet nothings in Thai. I mean, yeah, spice it up. But we're just going like, whoa, that image is bad for us. We don't want to go there. So he was not funded. So I'll quit there.
A few comments. You know, I've been a reader on a number of scholarships, and including the Boren on a number of occasions. I'm coming from that point of view. I've been a Fulbright scholar, Title VI scholarships, and I even had one that was just delivered to me. It turned out there's such a scholarship for people with a French-Canadian ancestry, and they just delivered it to me one day. I mean, somebody just donated some money, and you say you have to have this and this and study, and they said, congratulations, you have a scholarship. And it was like $800 or something, but I was happy to have it, and we take it. So that wasn't exactly competitive. I just had to have some genetic makeup, and a few times you have that. But why to apply, you know? I mean, money, prestige, we all need that, right? I'm always perplexed why more people don't apply. For the time, even if you don't get it, the chances are you will be prepared for doing other things, getting a grad school, doing other things. All good stuff. It's all good skill development. And who can't use some extra money and support to do what they have, you know? And then the other thing, success breeds success. And a lot of times, I deal with a lot of grants as well as looking at this. And you know, often you're funded because somebody else funds you. Because people are more, they're willing to take a risk if you've been funded. So what happens here, if you get one of these good scholarships, next time they're reading, say, oh, former Fulbright? You know, that makes them feel more comfortable about supporting you again. Oh, Fulbright, somebody looked at your background really well, and I think this probably person should get into graduate school. You know, it's taking the pressure off the reviewer sometimes. And so there's these things kind of build on themselves, and they're good things to do. Well, who reads them? You know, Dr. Hyer mentioned the 2 AM factor. It's definitely an issue. Everybody's doing volunteer. You're tired. You're looking for a thing. You got piles. You want to put more in that pile so you can pare it down and get down to business. That's a fact. It might seem kind of ugly to you in some ways, and you wish it weren't, but that's how it often happens, and there's a lot of emotional things. So I agree with that point. You know, I've gotten some comments from reviewers whom I know personally, who read them as well, and I often ask them if I get a chance, besides the ones I read myself, and they say, what do you think about BYU apps? And I get a few things that are really interesting. And one of the things is they often say they're excellent background, compete with everyone, but they don't write very well. I've heard this a number of times. They don't write as well. They compete with the elite schools on every way and background. They're interesting, but they don't write very well. And it's brutal, but I'm glad I hear that. And so I can't emphasize this enough. Make it some of the best writing you've ever done. I mean, this is not just filling out a form. It's writing. And you're presenting yourself. And it's everything. And striking the law balance, it's already been talked about, but make that good writing. Show it to people you trust. Let's get some feedback. Make it clean, absolutely clean, and make it good writing. And it will pay off even if you don't get the scholarship. It will pay off if you do that, I promise you. They often say that, you know, I get both sides of this. Sometimes they say the mission factor again. They say it's too churchy. Sometimes they say, why did they not even admit it? It's like they're trying to hide it. So this is this balancing issue where, on one hand, you don't want to just throw it out like, you know, it's a big black hole in your background. You know, oh, 2 years, I didn't do anything. That doesn't look good. But you talk about it, but it's all about contextualizing what you do and put it to the right audience. So yes, it's there, it's part of you, but you're not writing to a church audience. It's not a seminary. It's not something to be ashamed of. It's something good. It's something positive about your background. You've got to build and show what it means in your life. Sometimes the too personal thing comes up. They often say too personal. They will talk about their spouses and their children and why and the kind of things that Dr. Hyer mentioned, and that I hear all the time. That's another thing on my list. And sometimes it's too breezy, too informal, they say. You know, they just kind of tell a good story. You know, it's the missionary thing. You know, you're used to talking about your mission. You just kind of go into missionary recounting mode and you do that. Now, not everybody applies for these foreign missionaries, so we have different kind of things too. But that writing thing in a general thing, that's why I'm such an advocate for this, and that's why I want to be here today, because I think that we have a potential to get many more of these than we do. And I'm really happy to hear Cory say that we've had some increase in numbers, and I think you mentioned that too. And that's, I think it's all about writing in many cases. So some personal observations, you know, some application killers, and some of the things that, these are some of me, and some of them might not be another reader. It's sometimes you never know. But one of the first things I notice on the language side that turns me off is when they say, I learned the language. It's absolute turn off to me. Why? Anybody? It's the use of the perfective thing. It makes them think that that's done. They've checked it off. They're going, why am I funding? Why are we giving them money? They've already done that. Go off and do your thing. Instead, it's a small thing, but if you phrase it instead, I began learning my language in this context. And then you feel how that flows forward. That's a much better thing, and it's a small thing, but when everybody talks about whether it's language or something else, when they say the perfect aspect, it just doesn't work for me. It just seems like they're kind of flippant, and they said they don't even get what lifelong learning is. It's just like, okay, I got that, and I'm going to do something else. And so that's the kind of thing that jumps up. I like the lifestyle thing. I've heard that. I've seen that in a lot of things. I saw one student where I was reading, and he wanted to go join the Foreign Service. Why? Because my father was in the counselor service, and I become accustomed to the lifestyle. And everybody just turned off on that. Say, okay, this is all about making sure you have an appropriately comfortable lifestyle. He could have done that in different ways, right? He could have said instead something like, maybe he wants to bring that in. He says, I've learned the value of foreign service and growing up, and this has given me a firsthand. Now, there's a lot of ways to approach that, but not that way. Some other things, you know, the killers, absolute killers, spelling and grammar. If it happens, it's in that pile. Why? Not just because you happen to make a spelling mistake, because it means you didn't spend much time on it and you weren't serious, so why should I be serious? That's absolute, it's a goner if it is. I had one person, I'll tell you, it was for a Boren, and I think it was a $15,000 Boren, I think. And a committee member whom I know really well from a university in the East comes up to me, that was a really good thing, but I couldn't, with that letter, I couldn't recommend it. He left 15 grand on the table because he wasn't willing to take a little time to have it proofread by people. 15,000, pretty expensive. If you do the per word breakdown on that, that was an expensive miss on your spell check or having somebody proof it. I mean, he could have gotten that. It was a great application, but it was messy. That's in that pile. You know, the explicit religious tone, we talked about that. Some too much fluff. Sort of a bad recommendation. Again, I second that. ask somebody if they would feel comfortable writing for you. I often say that. That's I'd like it when people say, you know, would you feel comfortable writing this kind of application? And I might say, well, I think you might ask somebody else. I don't know if I know you as well. The other thing is make sure you're on the same page with your recommender. I've seen disconnects a lot. Like the recommender doesn't seem to know what you're applying for, and so they're writing for something else. So you must absolutely must give them the copy of your draft statement so they know it, even if you're not asking them for other reasons. I mean, make sure they know what you're applying for, your statement, your resume. Because sometimes they say, well, yes, I think this person would do fine in the Foreign Service. Well, they want to be an engineer. That's in that pile. Because it says they're not even serious. And that goes in the no pile. Things like that happen. Too grandiose is another one I see a lot. I'm doing this because I plan to be the Vice President of the United States or President, or I'm going to be the Ambassador of China. It comes off as being naive and sort of self-important and very funny, and it just comes, instead of saying, I plan to enter the Foreign Service, and, you know, okay, where it goes from there. But kind of too grandiose about it is a turnoff to most readers. You know, it's a balance between the sophistry. You know, you don't want to sound kind of foolish, but you don't want to sound like you're just writing for your own vanity. It's this balance, and you sometimes see that. I see sometimes overboard, like one of the examples we gave you, I'm sensitive to this too, being trying to out-humble everyone else, too. That doesn't come off well to me. So a little bit of this kind of story, if you say it naturally without self-consciousness, works. If you go too far, it's like, yes, I was the poorest of the poor. You know, you're out humbling each other, and you're trying to show how you are the toughest circumstance ever, and that's why you should give it to me. That doesn't work for me, and I know I've talked to people, other people don't. I mean, if it flows out naturally, just state it. Don't tell them how humble you were. Just say, this is my life, and this is where I went, and this is my story. I think that's most of it. I say what to put in, again, to contextualize whatever it is. And the last thing is really why you want it. This is one that a famous one that I had when I was reading the Bourne. It was a phenomenal student, 4.0, the whole works. They better this and this and this. And then what happened is we got done reading it. We all turned to each other and say, why do they want to do it? Other than they're done with school. They're done, and that's it. It was for a graduate thing. So, well, we're done. Okay, this is what, okay, why do I want? They didn't get around to saying why this, where else it goes. So that's it. And again, to contextualize it, the mission thing, I found something in your mission experience is important, then you have to tell them without going into too much detail. But I mean, it's all about that. It's all making it excellent writing. And I'm gonna end it there and let Professor Belknap finish up here.
So they pretty well covered the ground, and I would just say amen to so much. The thing I think I would really stress is, and the thing when I'm reading these things is, if it's just clear that this person really doesn't know what they're talking about, I don't care how well, you know, it can be just polished to the T. But if they are clueless as far as content goes, there it goes, right? So, and this comes to be, and I mean, you'd think, well, it's not all about writing. The writing is huge. You have to tell your story well. But if it isn't, if you don't have a story to tell, if you're just splashing in the shallow end, as far as, you know, whatever the content is, it's over. So be part of the conversation that you supposedly want to say that you're interested in being. If you reveal in your application that you really don't know that much about what you're talking about, doesn't matter how well the story is told, it will come out. So that takes time, and it's not just time for the application. It's your lifetime of reading and involvement, internships, et cetera, courses and extracurricular activity and volunteering for this and so forth. But one thing I really, really like about some of these, and I've got a particularly strong essay from a young woman who last year got a Boren and a Fulbright and Annie Samhuri, and she said we could. I think she would be fine to have it on display in your office. So I think that'd be a great thing if people want to go over and take a look. The nice thing about what she does is she demonstrates the why. She demonstrates having the investment, having done the research, having being part. She is part of the conversation, and that's what always impresses me when I think, wow. This person already looks like a really advanced graduate student. They really have gotten in and dug in, and so that's, you know, there's none of this gee whiz stuff. They've done their homework. They have a plan. They know what they're talking about. And let's save the rest for questions. Okay.